السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. وبعد, we will beginning once again with the Sheikh Ali Al-Halabi some of the issues of fiqh that are pertaining to our religion. He will be discussing once again to us. We will be beginning our discussion in the book of Tayammum, which is on page 19 for those of you who are following with us, inshaAllah ta'ala. فليتفضل مشكورا.
إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا وسيئات أعمالنا, من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له, وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له, وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. أما بعد, فإن أصدق الحديث كلام الله, وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم, وشر الأمور محدثاتها, وكل محدثة بدعة, وكل بدعة ضلالة, وكل ضلالة في النار. أما بعد, فهذا هو الدرس الرابع أيها الإخوة في الله من دروسنا في كتاب منهج السالكين وتوضيح الفقه في الدين للشيخ العلامة عبد الرحمن بن ناصر السعدي رحمة الله عليه. ولازلنا في أبحاث كتاب الطهارة. قال المصنف رحمه الله: باب التيمم, وهو النوع الثاني من الطهارة. وأما النوع الأول فهو ماذا؟ فهو الماء, فهو الطهارة بالماء. قال: وهو بدل عن طهارة الماء إذا تعذر استعمال الماء لأعضاء الطهارة أو بعضها لعدمه أو خوف ضرر باستعماله. إذن التيمم إنما يكون بدلا عن الماء للطهارة, وذلك إذا تعذر أي صعب وعثر استعمال الماء من قبل مسلم من المسلمين لأعضاء الطهارة من يد أو رجل أو وجه أو بعضها. قد يصاب إنسان بأذى في جسمه كله أو في بعض جسمه, فيكون هذا الأذى الكلي أو الجزئي سببا يتعذر من خلاله أن يتوضأ هذا المسلم بالماء, وذلك لسببين: إما لعدم وجود الماء, يعني كما قال الله فلم تجدوا ماء, أو خوف ضرر أو خوف ضرر باستعماله. قد يصاب بعض الناس ببعض الأمراض فإذا مس الماء أبدانهم قد يكون ذلك سببا لمزيد من الهلاك ومزيد من الضرر. وعندنا قاعدة شرعية صحيحة نبوية يقول فيها رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم: لا ضرر ولا ضرار, لا ضرر ولا ضرار. فيقوم التراب مقام الماء, فيقوم التراب مقام الماء بأن ينوي رفع ما عليه من الأحداث. إذن لابد من النية. قد قلنا بأن النية شرط في جميع الأعمال الشرعية, جميع الأعمال الشرعية. وذكرنا ونذكر ونكرر بأن النية شرط في الأعمال ولا دخل للسان بها, إنما علاقتها ماذا؟ علاقة قلبية, علاقة قلبية. والله
الشيخ أبو الحارث علي حسن علي عبد الحميد الحلبي حفظه الله began today by praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and sending the salah and the salam to our blessed Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and by bearing witness that there is no God or deity worthy of any type of worship except Allah, and by bearing witness that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is a slave of Allah and his final messenger. He continued by saying, Amma ba'd, surely the best of words are the words of Allah, and the best of guidance is that of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And truly the worst of all matters in religion are those that are newly invented or innovated. For every newly invented matter in religion is a bid'ah, and every bid'ah is a dhalalah, and every dhalalah leads to the fire. He continued by saying, Amma ba'd. Today we continue still in the chapter of At-Tahara, which is purification. We are now in the sub-chapter, which is At-Tayammum, learning how to make tayammum, which is purifying oneself without water. He continued by saying, At-Tayammum, it is the second form or the secondary form of tahara. The first primary form of tahara is using what? Water. The second form of tahara is at-tayammum, and it is used in lieu of or instead of tahara with water due to difficulty of the usage of water at a specific time. It is in lieu of using water due to the difficulty the usage of water would cause at a specific time. He continues by saying there are two reasons where tayammum would be used. The first reason is that water is not found, so you would be forced to use tayammum. Second is that you are in fear that if you use water, it will cause a problem that is more difficult than what you are in. Meaning, if you have an illness or an open womb, and if you use water, it will cause an infection or so forth. Therefore, if there is water, you have to use the water instead of the dirt. Now, unless there's an illness that you have that would be more spread by the water. He continues by saying, water therefore takes the place, therefore dust or dirt takes the place of water in At-Tahara. Before beginning At-Tayammum, obviously the first and foremost in all acts of ibadah is a niyyah, intention. And this is something we have stated before, and we state again, and will continue to state, that the person must make the intention that when he is performing tayammum, he is cleansing himself or preparing himself as if he is doing so with wudu.
قال ثم يقول بسم الله. بسم الله قلنا بأنها شرط أو ركن، وأن تعمد تركها في الوضوء مبطل للصلاة، مبطل للوضوء، وأن تركها جهلا أو سهوا أو خطأ أو نسيانا ليس مبطلا إن شاء الله. ثم يضرب التراب بيده مرة واحدة ثم يمسح بها جميع وجهه وجميع كفيه. طريقة التيمم أن يضرب الأرض بيديه ثم يمسح بهما وجهه وكفيه، فقط الكفان، فقط الكفان والوجه. والمقصود بالضرب التراب المسح، وليس أن يحمل التراب ويضعه على وجهه، هذا ليس هو من الشرع في شيء. قال فإن ضرب مرتين فلا بأس. أقول قد ورد ذلك في بعض الروايات، لكن لا يصح ولا يثبت وهو شاذ. والصواب أن التيمم ضربة واحدة لا غير على ما شرحت. قال الله تعالى فلم تجدوا ماء فتيمموا صعيدا طيبا فامسحوا بوجوهكم وأيديكم منه. ما يريد الله ليجعل عليكم من حرج، ولكن يريد ليطهركم وليتم نعمته عليكم لعلكم تشكرون. إذن هذه الآية هي آية التيمم، وقد ذكر الله تعالى فيها أنه إنما شرع التيمم لدفع الحرج وللتطهير ولإتمام النعمة. ووالله إنها نعمة، نعمة الإسلام ونعمة السنة ونعمة العلم ونعمة العمل الصالح.
ده شيخ حفظه الله continued by saying
رحمك الله
continued by saying once the person has made the intention inside himself and the intention is always done in the heart never spoken, the Sheikh continued by saying after this is done the person is to say Bismillah with the name of Allah, Bismillah. And this is important because we have mentioned to you that the wudu of a person who intends willingly and knowing the importance of saying Bismillah and doesn't say Bismillah on purpose, his wudu is nullified. As for the person who forgets or does not know, his wudu is still kept intact. But the Sheikh continues by saying that he is to say Bismillah and he is to strike the earth with both of his hands one time. He is to strike the earth or the dirt one time and then he is to pass his hands over his face and ring them around in his hand and to pass them around his hand, not his elbows, not his forearm, just his hand. So to strike the earth once and then to pass the hands over the face and then to wipe the hands with it. He continues by saying that the person that Sheikh Muhammad Sheikh Al-Sa'di in his book states if he strikes the ground twice it is fine. The Sheikh corrects and says the hadith narrating that to strike the earth twice, they are not authentic and therefore not reliable. So it is to strike the earth just once. And then the Shaykh recited to us from Surah Al-Ma'idah, verse number 6, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and you find no water, then perform tayammum with clean earth and rub therein with your face, faces and hands. Allah does not want to put you in difficulty, but He wants you to be pure. He wants to purify you and to complete His favor to you that you may be thankful. And truly it is a great ni'mah, a grace from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He facilitates to us the ability to make salah, to pray, even when we don't have water so that we could make the wudu. Everything has been made easy in worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is a great ni'mah to have al-Islam, a great name, a great grace to have the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.
قال وعن جابر أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال أعطيت خمسا لم يعطهن أحد من الأنبياء قبلي نصرت بالرعب مسيرة شهر نصرت بالرعب مسيرة شهر أي في جهاده وغزواته صلى الله عليه وسلم نصره الله بأن يلقي في قلوب الذين كفروا الرعب ويثبت أقدام المؤمنين من أصحاب رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم وذلك الرعب يكون من مسيرة شهر بحيث يخافون ويرتعبون ويفرقون وجعلت لي الأرض مسجدا وطهورا مسجدا أي موضعا للسجود إذا لم يكن هنالك مسجد فالأرض كلها مسجد ولكن هذا الحديث يجب أن يفهم إذا لم يكن هنالك مسجد مبني لإقامة الصلاة وذكر الله فأي مكان في الأرض إلا المقبرة والحمام فإنه يجوز الصلاة فيه وأيضا كذلك بعض الأمور وقد ذكرنا شيئا منها وسيأتي شيء آخر كمعاصن الإبل أيضا لا يجوز الصلاة فيها وطهورا أي ليتيمم المسلم فيها عند فقده الماء فأيما رجل أدركته الصلاة فليصلي في مكان من الأرض الطهور إن لم يجد ماء إن لم يجد مسجدا وأحلت لي الغنائم التي يغنمها المسلمون في حروبهم ضد الكفار ولم تحل لأحد قبلي وقد كانت محرمة لكن الله تعالى اختص بها هذه الأمة واختص بها نبي هذه الأمة صلى الله عليه وسلم، وأعطيت الشفاعة، الشفاعة التي يشفع بها رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم بإذن ربه للفساق من المسلمين. وأنواع شفاعات رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم 10 مذكورة في كتب العقائد، ولا تكون الشفاعة لكافر، إنما هي لمسلم. رحمك الله. وكان النبي يبعث إلى قومه خاصة، وبعثت إلى الناس عامة، وما أرسلناك إلا رحمة للعالمين، للإنس والجن أجمعين، فليس فقط للعرب أو لقريش أو لفئة من الناس أو جيل في زمان أو مكان، وإنما للناس كافة. رحمك الله. متفق عليه.
The Sheikh continued, Hafizahullah, by reading to us from the beginning of page number 20. وعن جابر, from the narration of Jabir, أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال, that our blessed messenger Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم said, I have been given 5 things that were not given to any prophet before me. I was given 5 things by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that were not given to any messenger or prophet before me. First, I was given victory through terror. Our enemies fear us a month in advance, meaning a month before they set out to wage the battle. The enemies of Al-Islam at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they would have already been demoralized because of the news that he was coming sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And through their terror, the victory would be given to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam a month before the battle is even waged. Also, the earth has been made a masjid, and its earth is tahur, it is clean for me, has been made clean for me and my ummah. Meaning, and he continues sallallahu alaihi wasallam, therefore any person who finds himself in the time of salah and there is no masjid, he is to pray wherever he may be on the face of the earth. Here the Shaykh gives us an important point, except in these 3 places. You cannot pray in a graveyard, or in the bathroom, or in the stalls of camels, or the stables of camels, the place where camels sleep overnight. And the earth has been made fahur, meaning it can be used to purify oneself. Also, the Rasulullah ﷺ, number 3, from the things that he was given, is that al-ghanaim, the things of war booty, when there is a war that is waged, whatever is left after the war can be divided amongst the ummah, and it is deemed halal for the Nabi ﷺ to partake from it. And this was not given to anyone before me, to be able to enjoy the war spoils, the spoils of war. Number 4, and I have been given al-shafa'a. I have been given the ability to intercede for my ummah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And therefore the shafa'a, it is solely for those who believe in Allah and believe in Him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It is not for any of the disbelievers. And 5th and finally, وَكَانَ النَّبِيُّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ وَكَانَ النَّبِيُّ, a prophet would be sent, يُبْعَثُ إِلَىٰ قَوْمِهِ خَاصَّةً, that a prophet would be sent only to a specific people. Before Rasulullah ﷺ, Allah would send a messenger or prophet to one group of people only. He wouldn't be required for all of mankind. وَبُعِثُ إِلَى النَّاسِ عَامَّةً, but I was sent to all mankind. Other prophets and other messengers were sent just for their people. Moses for the Jews, as so forth, only for a specific group of people. But Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was sent for all mankind, and the Shaykh also says, mankind and the jinn, he was sent by sallam for mankind and jinn, and not just for Quraysh, or not just for the Arabs, he was sent for everyone who has the ability to understand La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah, and the hadith is muttafaqun alayhi.
ثم قال المصنف رحمه الله: ومن عليه حدث أصغر، أي منتقد الوضوء فقط، لم يحل له أن يصلي ولا أن يطوف بالبيت ولا يمس المصحف. أما الطواف بالبيت فنعم، ويلحق به على قول بعض أهل العلم السعي بين الصفا والمروة، لأن الله تبارك وتعالى سمى السعي بين الصفا والمروة طوافا، إن الصفا والمروة من شعائر الله، فمن حج البيت أو اعتمر فلا جناح عليه أن يطوف بهما. قال: ولا يمس المصحف، لأن النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام قال: لا تمس القرآن إلا وأنت طاهر. وفي هذا الحديث إشارة إلى أن هذا هو الأصل، أنه لا يمس المصحف إلا طاهر أي متوضئ. وإن كان في المسألة بعض خلاف بين أهل العلم، لكن الأحوط ذلك. قال: ويزيد عليه من عليه حدث أكبر، ويزيد من عليه حدث أكبر، أي على من عليه حدث أصغر، أنه لا يقرأ شيئا من القرآن، وهذا لا دليل عليه. وفي البخاري عن ابن عباس أنه كان لا يرى في القراءة للجنب بأسا، ولا يلبث في المسجد بلا وضوء، وهذا أيضا لا دليل عليه. فقد ورد عن الصحابة أنهم كانوا يجلسون في المسجد بلا وضوء، ولا يوجد دليل أصلا على ذلك. أما قوله تعالى: ولا جنبا إلا عابري سبيل حتى تغتسلوا، فالمقصود بها المسافر، فالمقصود بها المسافر وأحكامه، وليس المقصود بها المكفي المسجد. قال: وتزيد الحائض والنفساء أنها لا تصوم، ولا يحل وطؤها ولا طلاقها. نعم، لا يحل طلاقها فهو ممنوع، ولكن إذا طلق الحائض زوجها هل يصح أم لا يصح؟ نقول يصح مع وقوع الإثم. صحيح في مسألة طلاق الحائض أنه يصح ويقع، ولكن يكون صاحبه الموقعه آثما.
The Sheikh continued by saying, for the person who is in the minor form of impurity, the person who is in the minor form of impurity, he is not permitted to pray, and he is not permitted to make the tawaf around Al-Kaaba, and he is not permitted to hold Al-Mushaf, to hold the book of the Quran. The Sheikh explains, obviously, all of us know you are not permitted to pray without wudu, and also you are not permitted to make the tawaf, because the tawaf, it is part of the sha'air, it is part of the rites of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, sacred rites that we perform, and therefore one has to be in wudu in doing so. As for touching the mushaf, the Shaykh explained, there is disagreement amongst the scholars in this, but what is most correct, and what he feels is what would be the closest to the truth, is that it would be not permitted. You are not permitted to hold the mushaf if you are in a state of hadath asghar, meaning you are not in a state of wudu, because this is something that is of closer protecting of the sanctity. It is protecting the sanctity of the Quran. Also, the Shaykh increases to us, reading to us from the book, if a person is in a state of hadath akbar, meaning he is in a major impurity, meaning he is junub, he is not permitted to recite the Quran. Here the Shaykh pauses and says, there is no proof to this statement. A person is permitted to recite the Quran if he is in a state of junub, obviously not holding from the book, as was stated by Abi Huraira radiallahu anhu, and the statements are in Sahih al-Bukhari. Shaykh al-Sa'di also states that the person who does not have wudu should not be residing in the masjid for extended periods of time. Here the Shaykh pauses and says, once again, there is no proof for this statement, for it is known that many of the Sahaba of Rasulullah ﷺ would remain in the masjid for extended periods of time, even if they were not in wudu. he increases a little more on the requirement of tahara. Al-Shaykh al-Sa'di continues by saying, the woman who is in a state of her menstrual cycle, or who is nufasa, she has had her baby and she is in the 40 days of bleeding after giving birth, that she is not permitted to fast in those days, and she is not permitted to pray in those days when she is in her menstrual cycle or when she is bleeding out after birth, and she is not to be approached for sexual relations, and she is not to be divorced in that time period. The Sheikh says, if a person does happen to divorce his wife in that time period, the divorce is taken. It is counted against him. It is counted as a divorce. And he incurs the sin of going against what is proper, which is not to divorce her when she is in her talaq.
ثم قال المصنف رحمه الله والأصل في الدم الذي يصيب المرأة أنه حيض بلا حد لسنه ولا قدره ولا تكرره لسنه أي أيامه فالمرأة إذا جاءها الحيض ونزل دمها فهذا حيض سواء كان يوما أو أسبوعا أو أكثر أو أقل ولا قدره أي كميته سواء كانت كثيرة أم قليلة ولا تكرره أي تعدد وروده وعدم انقطاعه إلا إن أطبق على المرأة أي سيطر عليها وصار كثيرا منهمرا مستمرا أو صار لا ينقطع عنها إلا يسيرا يقع ذلك طيلة حياتها أو معظم عمرها فما هو العمل؟ هل تظل حائضا وبالتالي تنقطع عن الصوم والصلاة وإلى آخر الأحكام؟ قال فإنها تصير مستحاضة أي بأثناء هذه المدة الزائدة فقد أمرها النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام أن تجلس عادتها عادتها أي الوقت المعلوم لذلك تسمى هذه يسمى الحيض عادة أو دورة في اللغة لأنه يدور على المرأة ويتكرر عليها فإن لم يكن لها عادة فإلى تمييزها إذا لم يكن لها عادة أحيانا يأتيها الحيض 5 أيام أحيانا أسبوع أحيانا 10 أيام ليس لها عادة معينة فإلى تمييزها بماذا تميز المرأة حيضها بلون الدم وبرائحته فلون الدم أسود والرائحة نتنة بخلاف الدم العادي فإنه أحمر ورائحته طبيعية فإن لم يكن لها تمييز فإذا لم تستطع أن تميز وأشكل عليها فإلى عادة النساء الغالبة 6 أيام أو 7 تنظر بنات جنسها ومن يحوط بها من النساء من أخواتها النساء فالغالب أن المرأة تحيض من 5 أيام إلى 10 والأغلب من 6 أيام أو 7 أيام حينئذ ينظر أو تنظر عادة أخواتها النساء لتطبق على نفسها ما هو عليها وما كان زائدا عن هذه الأيام 7 مثلا ولا يزال دمها ينزل فإنها حينئذ تكون مستحاضة تكون مستحاضة أي أنها تتوضأ لكل فريضة إذا دخل وقتها وتلجم نفسها في خرقة تمنع نزول دمها وسيلانه والله أعلم.
The Sheikh continues in reading to us about some of the purity or purification issues for the Muslim woman by saying, as for the blood that exits the Muslim woman or the woman, it is considered hayd and it should not be counted in degree of days or amount, or that it is non-stop. Like, you cannot say that Hajj, it has this many days. You cannot say it could be 5 days, or the limit is 7 days. There is no limit that is to be counted by days. Or amount of bleeding. You can't say, I've bled so much, so therefore all of the Hajj is over. Or you cannot say that I've been bleeding for non-stop for so many days, therefore it is over, as long as there's still blood coming out. Except that the blood of the woman, if it continues non-stop for extended periods of time, and that she only stops bleeding for shorter time than she is bleeding, if she is bleeding more days than she is not bleeding, it can be considered that she is in a state of natural blood, or that it is a vein that is bleeding. After so many days, she can consider the blood that is coming out, that it is natural blood, istihaba. And the Shaykh explains by saying that An-Nabiyya sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to tell the women, if they are bleeding for extended periods of time, that they are to sit and count their normal period. And this is where the word period comes from. The normal period that she has, her ada, the normal period that she's had throughout her life, she is to count those days, whether 6 or 7 or 10, as being the principle that she has in her life. And for the days that she's increased over it, she is to check the blood by looking at it. If it is darker than what it usually is, therefore she is still in her period, because the blood of the menstrual cycle is dark and it is stenchy, it is smelly. So if her blood is dark and it has a bad smell to it, she is to consider herself in her period. But once her blood changes color to a natural looking reddish color, and it doesn't have that pungent or evil smell or bad smell, she is to consider herself an istihaba. And al-istihada means that she is to pray her prayers, but she has to make wudu for every prayer she prays. And that she must place something that will stop the bleeding so that it does not spoil her clothing and so forth. If she doesn't have the ability to tell the difference of the blood because of its smell or color, through its smell or color, then she is to look to the regular course days of her other Muslim sisters. And the Shaykh says she should look to a person who's equal to her, whether in race, in weight, things like this, so that she could actually measure out or make a similarity that is based on something where there are some principles to it. So she's to look to someone who is similar to her, ask her how many days she stays, and follow her routine until she returns to hers. Did you understand the points that are being made? Al-Istihada, quickly. I will say quickly to you one more time so you could fill in your notes. A woman is considered in her period. It shouldn't be counted by how many days, or by the amount of blood that has been brought out, or whether it is non-stop or not, unless the bleeding is more days than she is days without bleeding. When she is in this situation, she is to count back to her regular routine. So if her whole life she's been a person who she bleeds only for 6 days, and then for the last 2 or 3 months she's been bleeding for 15 days, she is to say, my regular routine was 6 days, so she would count her 6 days of bleeding, and the other days that are over that, she would count it as istihaba, meaning natural blood due to a vein. If that does not work, or if she did not know how many days she used to do before, she is to look at the blood itself. If the blood is dark and pungent and has a bad smell, that is to be considered the blood of the period, of her menstrual cycle. Once it changes color to a more natural color of blood and doesn't have that pungent smell, then she is to know she is now in istihaba, natural bleeding due to a vein or a ruptured vessel or something of this nature. If she cannot tell the difference of her blood, then she is to look and ask other Muslim sisters who are similar to her in size, in weight, in lineage, things like this, in nationality, so that she could make an informed guess and she is to follow their routine until she returns to her regular routine. Wallahu a'lam. No.
وهذا كتاب جديد هو كتاب الصلاة. قال المصنف رحمه الله: تقدم أن الطهارة من شروطها، بمعنى أن صلاة بغير طهارة لا تصح. قال: ومن شروطها دخول الوقت أيضا. صلاة بغير دخول الوقت قبل الوقت أو بعده فإنها باطلة لا تصح. قال: والأصل فيه أي دخول الوقت حديث جبريل أنه أما النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم في أول الوقت وآخره وقال: يا محمد الصلاة ما بين هذين الوقتين، الصلاة ما بين هذين الوقتين، فكل صلاة لها أول ولها آخر، ما بين الأول والآخر تصح الصلاة، أما قبل الأول أو بعد الآخر فالصلاة تكون غير صحيحة. قال: رواه أحمد والنسائي والترمذي. وعن عبد الله بن عمر رضي الله عنهما أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال: وقت الظهر إذا زالت الشمس، أي زالت من كبد السماء، من وسط السماء، وكان ظل الرجل كطوله، يعني الظل وصاحبه يكونان متساويين بطولا، ما لم تحضر العصر إلى صلاة العصر، ووقت العصر ما لم تصفر الشمس وتبدأ بالهوي والسقوط والنزول والغروب، أما قبل ذلك فكله وقت عصر. ووقت صلاة المغرب ما لم يغب الشفق، والشفق هو اللون الأحمر الذي يكون في جهة المغرب في الأفق، ويكون عقب غروب الشمس، فطالما هذا موجود، طالما وقت المغرب موجود، فإذا زال هذا الشفق ولم يبق إلا السواد فحينئذ يخرج وقت المغرب ومباشرة يدخل وقت العشاء. قال: ووقت صلاة العشاء إلى نصف الليل. ونصف الليل ليس هو الساعة 12 كما يتوهم كثير من الناس، وإنما نصف الليل هو نصف وقت طول الليل، وطول الليل من المغرب مبتدئا إلى الفجر منتهيا، فمنتصف المسافة بين المغرب والفجر هو نصف الليل، وقد يكون حينا في الساعة 12، قد يكون حينا في الساعة 11 أو 11:30 أو 12:30، ويختلف هذا باختلاف طول الليل وقصره. قال: ووقت صلاة الصبح من طلوع الفجر ما لم تطلع الشمس، ما لم تطلع الشمس. رواه مسلم.
The Sheikh said, now we are beginning a brand new chapter, which is the chapter of Salah. And you can follow along in page number 21. The Sheikh, in his book, he states, obviously we have laid down the foundation that Tahara, purifying oneself, is from the shurut. It is from the shurut, the prerequisites of Salah. Meaning that without Tahara, Salah is not accepted. Also from the shurut, from the shart that is required for salah, is that the time of salah has to enter. You cannot pray before and you cannot pray after the time of salah has entered. And the reason for this, it is built on the hadith of Jibreel which is found in Al-Imam Ahmad and Al-Nasa'i and Al-Tirmidhi's book, that he, Jibreel alayhi salam, led Rasulullah s.a.w. in prayer, teaching him the prayer and its time. And he led the salah with the Rasul s.a.w. He led him in prayer at the beginning of each time and at the end of each time. And then he told him, Ya Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, salah, it is to be what is in between the beginning and the end of the time. And therefore we see the hadith of Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu anhu, that an-Nabiyya sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, the time of Salatul Dhuhr is from when the sun reaches its zenith, when it reaches high noon, and the shadow of a man is equal to his height. That's the beginning of Salatul Dhuhr. When the sun reaches its apex or its zenith, and the height of a man's shadow is equal to his length, or the length of a man's shadow is equal to his height. And until Asr has not entered, meaning from that moment until Asr enters. وَوَقْتُ الْعَصْرِ, and Asr enters when the sun begins to descend into dusk, or into, begins to fall under the horizon. It is from the moment it begins to dip from the high noon, and it begins to change its color from its hotness and brightness to a whiter or a yellowish tint, and begins its way down to the horizon. And this is when Salatul Asr enters, and Salatul Dhuhr elapses. Salatul Maghrib enters. Salatul Maghrib is established from once the sun dips below the horizon, and as long or until there is redness in the sky. Once the redness of the sky is no longer present, Salatul Maghrib is over. Once the sky turns dark and there's no more redness, Salatul Maghrib. Once there is no more redness in the sky and the sun has already gone down the horizon, and you cannot see any more bright redness in the sky and it becomes dark, therefore Maghrib has entered and has gone when there is no more redness in the sky. Maghrib enters as soon as the sun goes below the horizon. And it remains at Salatul Maghrib's time until all the redness of the sky elapses. Salatul Isha enters when it is dark. And it remains until the middle of the night. You can pray Isha until the middle of the night. Not until Fajr, until the middle of the night. And the middle of the night does not mean midnight. That is not what it is to mean. It means that you count the hours from the time Maghrib started, when the sun has dipped, to Fajr. The middle hour of that time, that is the final extent that you are allowed to pray Isha. And that varies, therefore. Sometimes Fajr is at 4:30, sometimes it's at 6, and sometimes Maghrib is at 5, and sometimes it's at 8:30 or 9 o'clock. So you have to measure the time so that you know, so it's not a standard time, midnight, 11 p.m. or 1 a.m. or so forth. And the time for Salatul Fajr is right before the sun rises, up to and until the sun rises or dawn sets in. Once the sun rises, Salatul Fajr, its time has finished. It starts after the midnight, you count the third part of the night, after that Salatul Fajr comes in. Before the sun rises, you must begin your prayer of Salatul Fajr.
قال المصنف رحمه الله ويدرك وقت الصلاة بإدراك ركعة لقوله صلى الله عليه وسلم من أدرك ركعة من الصلاة فقد أدرك الصلاة متفق عليه. وكذلك يقول نبينا صلى الله عليه وسلم من أدرك ركعة من صلاة الفجر قبل أن تطلع الشمس فقد أدرك الصلاة، ومن أدرك ركعة من صلاة العصر قبل أن تغرب الشمس فقد أدرك الصلاة. نقول هذا الإدراك للصلاة، وإلا فإن من كان معذورا عذرا شرعيا وفاتته الصلاة فإنه مدرك لفضلها وإن فاته وقتها. وتأتي لذلك مزيد بيانا إن شاء الله. قال ولا يحل تأخيرها أي تأخير الصلاة أو تأخير بعضها عن وقتها لعذر أو غيره إلا إذا أخرها ليجمعها مع غيرها. أما قوله لعذر فإذا كان هذا العذر مؤثرا جدا بحيث فعلا يكون مانعا لا يكلف الله نفسا إلا وسعها، أما إذا لم يكن مانعا فحينئذ نقول الأصل أنه لا يلتفت لمثل هذا العذر. قال إلا إذا أخرها ليجمعها مع غيرها، فإنه يجوز لعذر من سفر أو مطر أو مرض أو نحوها. فالجمع بين الصلاتين إنما يكون عن عذر، أما بغير عذر فلا يجوز. قد ورد عن عمر بن الخطاب رضي الله تعالى عنه أنه قال من جمع بين الصلاتين من غير عذر فقد أتى بابا من أبواب الكبائر، فقد أتى بابا من أبواب الكبائر. قال والأفضل تقديم الصلاة في أول وقتها، أحب الأعمال إلى الله الصلاة لأول وقتها كما قال عليه الصلاة والسلام، إلا العشاء إذا لم يشق أي لم يكن عسرا على الناس ولم يستطيعوا القيام به، لأن النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام قال لولا أن أشق على أمتي لأمرتهم بتأخير العشاء إلى منتصف الليل، لأمرتهم بتأخير العشاء إلى منتصف الليل. قال وإلا الظهر في شدة الحر عند اشتداد الحرارة يسن تأخير صلاة الظهر وعدم إقامتها في وقتها. قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم إذا اشتد الحر فأبردوا عن الصلاة فإن شدة الحر من فيح جهنم، متفق عليه، من فيحها ومن حرارتها ومن شديد أثرها. بل قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم اشتكت جهنم إلى ربها فقالت ربي إن بعضي أكل بعضي، فأذن لها بنفسين، نفس في الصيف وهو أشد ما تذوقون من الحرارة، ونفس في الشتاء وهو أشد ما تذوقون من البرد.
The Sheikh continued by saying Salah a person will get its reward in of Jaba'ah if he enters the Salah and prays a single rak'ah or a single prostration with the person. If he catches even one ruku'ah, one bowing, he has captured the Salah with the person who was leading it. As Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said, whoever captures a single ruku' of the salah, he has captured the salah. Meaning that if even if you're praying alone and the time of salah is about to go out and you make the first ruku' before the time elapses, you have caught the salah in its specified time, even if it is only one ruku', as the hadith is muttafaqun alayh. And the Sheikh shall discuss this further with us in the chapters of ruku' and so forth. Also, Sheikh As-Sa'di continues by saying, it is not permitted to delay the salah, except for a valid reason, to delay the salah from praying it at its beginning time, except for a valid reason that restricts you, or to delay salah out of its time, unless there is something that truly has restricted you from establishing the prayer at its specified time. Unless you are going to be praying the two prayers joined together, meaning you're going to pray Asr and Dhuhr and Asr together, Maghrib and Isha together, due to a valid excuse or reason, travel, or there is excessive amounts of weather conditions or rain that will cause you to pray Dhuhr and Asr together so you don't have to go out once again to the masjid or so forth, or illness, you don't have the ability to make wudu many times a day so you make it once and you pray the two salahs together, أو نحوها, or other things that are important reason. And al-afdal, the Sheikh explained to us, Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu stated, the one who delays the prayer and joins them together without a valid reason, he has entered a door of the doors of kaba'ir, major sins. والأفضل, and what is best and should be done, the salah is to be prayed at the beginning of its time, except for al-isha, salat al-isha. It is better to delay it from as soon as it enters, delay it a little bit. As the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has once said, if I did not fear that it would be of hardship on my ummah, I would have ordered them to pray al-isha at the time of midnight. At its midnight. Also we see, wa-dhuh, salat al-dhuh, you may delay it if there is too much heat. In some places, in some countries, or at the time of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it will get so hot that it would be of a great inconvenience for the people to gather together for the salah, so they would delay it. And this is what was said by Rasulullah ﷺ in the hadith that is agreed upon. If there is great heat, if it is extremely hot, delay your prayer until you can come together for the heat. It is from the, for this heat, it is from the heat of Jahannam. And therefore there's another hadith where the Rasul ﷺ says, Jahannam complained to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and said, my insides have eaten one another. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allowed Jahannam to inhale one time a year and exhale one time a year. The time it inhales, it is the coldest weather you will receive in the dunya. And the time Jahannam exhales, it is the hottest or the most heat that you will receive in the dunya.
ثم قال المصنف رحمه الله ومن فاتته الصلاة وجب عليه المبادرة إلى قضائها مرتبا فإن نسي الترتيب أو جهله أو خاف فوت الصلاة سقط الترتيب والمراد هنا بفوت الصلاة فوتها بعذر وليس فوتها بغير عذر تكاسلا وتهاونا إذ النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول من نام عن صلاة أو نسيها فليصلها حين يذكرها لا كفارة لها إلا ذلك ونص القرآن الكريم إن الصلاة كانت على المؤمنين كتابا موقوتا فالأصل عند فوت الصلاة إذا تعددت أن تصلى على الترتيب كما حصل يوم غزوة الخندق عندما فاتت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم عدة صلوات فصلاها مرتبة وكان ذلك قبل مشروعية صلاة الخوف فإن نسي الترتيب أو جهله أو خاف فوت الصلاة وهو يريد استحضار هذا الترتيب فإنه يسقط سقط الترتيب فإنه يسقط لا يكلف الله نفسا إلا وسعها ما جعل لكم في الدين من حرج قال ومن شروطها ستر العورة بثوب مباح لا يصف البشرة أما قوله بثوب مباح يعني ليس بثوب محرم كان يكون ثوبا مسروقا أو ثوبا فيه تشبه بالكفار أو ثوبا منهيا عنه لا يصف البشرة أي لا يحدد العورة وكذلك لا يشف عنها أي لا يكون ظاهرا ما تحت هذا الثوب من بدن نعم
The Sheikh continues by saying the one who misses salah for a valid reason, the Sheikh adds, for a valid reason or a valid excuse, he is to make up the prayers in their proper sequence. Meaning if he missed Salatul Dhuhr and Asr, he is to pray Dhuhr before he prays Salatul Asr. And the Sheikh reminds us that if one misses Salah, it is to be for a proper reason or for something that is valid. And from these things is that Rasulullah ﷺ says, if a person is excessively tired and he falls asleep or he forgets that he should have prayed, he, as soon as he wakes up and realizes that he has not prayed, he is to pray it as soon as possible. And that, as we said, the prayer should be done in sequence. But if the person forgets the sequence that it should be in. He doesn't know Dhuhr, Asr, he doesn't know which one he missed. He is to pray them, or if he thinks that by praying in sequence he will miss the salah that he is required to perform at that time, meaning he hasn't prayed Asr and Salatul Maghrib, its time has already arrived. And if he prays Asr first before Maghrib, Salatul Maghrib is going to elapse. It is better for him to pray Maghrib and then pray Asr. But that is only if the time of that salah that he is in is going to leave. But if he has time, he should pray Asr first, then Maghrib. Do you understand the example? Now, we will save the question inshallah. And from the shurut also of salah, from the requirements of salah, other than tahara and the time, remember we said so far we've listed you two, that you must be purified, and second that the time of salah must enter. The third shurut is al-awra, that a person must have himself covered properly, dressed in proper garment that does not discern or show what is underneath it, meaning it's not too tight or it's not see-through, and that it covers his awra properly. And now the Shaykh will discuss the levels of al-awra and so forth.
قال والعورة ثلاثة أنواع مغلظة يعني شديدة وهي عورة المرأة الحرة البالغة فإن جميع بدنها عورة في الصلاة إلا وجهها ومخففة وهي عورة من 7 سنين إلى 10 فإنها الفرجان وسبب تخفيفها أن من هذا سنه لا يقع عليه تكليف أصلا وبالتالي هذا يكون باب التربية وهي ومتوسطة وهي عورة من عداهم أي من سواهم من الرجال بطبيعة الحال لأن الأول في المرأة والثاني في الصبيان والثالث في الرجال فمن السرة إلى الركبة قال تعالى يا بني آدم خذوا زينتكم عند كل مسجد يا بني آدم خذوا زينتكم عند كل مسجد فالزينة ستر العورة عند كل مسجد أي عند كل موضع سجود وهو الصلاة. وها هنا نقطة مهمة وهي وجوب ستر الكتفين في الصلاة الكتف العاتق. يقول النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام لا صلاة لمن ليس على عاتقه من ثوبه شيء فستر العاتق وهو الكتف في الصلاة أمر واجب بل بعضهم ذكر ركنيته وأن عدم فعله يؤدي إلى بطلان الصلاة وهذا التقسيم للعورة المغلظة والمخففة والمتوسطة لم يرد عليه دليل صريح بهذا النوع أو بهذا التقسيم والتنويع وإنما هذا من باب التيسير والاستقراء والتتبع وهو مقبول جدا إن شاء الله.
The Shaykh continues by saying, after we mentioned to you that al-awra, it must be covered with proper garment that does not describe or discern what is underneath it, whether by being see-through or too tight. The Shaykh says, al-awra is of 3 levels. Awra that is major, or it is major awra, which is the awra of the woman. The awra of the woman who is free and who has reached the age of puberty. She is a free woman and has reached the age of puberty, meaning she wasn't a slave or something of this nature. Her whole body is considered awra in the time of salah except her face. The whole of her body is awra in salah except her face. As the second stage of awra is that of young children from ages 7 to 10. Their awra is their private areas. That must be covered when they are praying, when they are 7 or 10 to 10 years old. Obviously underneath that or up to that level, the Sheikh says that the reason that he has made this requirement is in fact they are not really required to pray at the age 10 unless they've reached the age of puberty. So it's just from bab al-tarbiyah to teach them and to train them about the importance of salah without making it too difficult for them. So therefore your child may stand in salah when they're 7 years old or 10 years old in something that is not a full garment like how you would be required or your wife would be required to be dressed in. And the third level of awrah, which is the lowest, it is the awrah that must be covered from the navel, and this is the awrah of the man, from his navel to his knees. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said in Surah Al-A'raf, Ya Bani Adam, O children of the Adam, take your adornment, meaning wear your clean clothes while praying. While praying. And you must cover yourself with this clothing. And from the clothing that you must cover yourself, from your belly button or from your navel to your knees, the Sheikh also adds that there's the hadith of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam where he says, no salah will be accepted from the one who does not cover his shoulders with a garment in salah. Your shoulders must be covered in salah. And this has caused many of the people of understanding and of fiqh to state that it is wajib. It is wajib to cover your shoulders while you're in prayer. Some have even placed it at the level of rukn. It is a prerequisite. Therefore, the salah is not accepted from the person who does not cover his shoulders if he knows that he should be covering it and so forth.
قال رحمه الله ومنها أي من الشروط للصلاة استقبال القبلة. قال تعالى ومن حيث خرجت فول وجهك شطر المسجد الحرام أي تجاهه، فإن عجز عن استقبالها لمرض أو غيره، لمرض لا يستطيع أو غيره لم يعرف أن يحددها، سقط هذا الشرط كما تسقط جميع الواجبات فضلا عن الشروط بالعجز عنها. قال تعالى فاتقوا الله ما استطعتم، وهذا من توفيق الله لعباده أنه لم يكلفهم إلا ما يستطيعون، أما ما لا يستطيعون فلا يكلفهم إياه، بل يسقط التكليف لعدم الاستطاعة. وكان النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يصلي في السفر النافلة على راحلته حيث توجهت به، متفق عليه، وفي لفظ غير أنه لا يصلي عليه المكتوبة. إذن صلاة النافلة تصلى ولو على غير قبلة إذا كانت على دابة أو طائرة أو سيارة، أما الفريضة فلا يصلى منها شيء إلا باتجاه القبلة. ومن شروطها النية، ومن شروط صحة الصلاة النية، وقلنا بأن النية عمل قلبي ونكرر، وليس للسان شأن بها، وتصح الصلاة في كل موضع، كما قال النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام جعلت لي الأرض مسجدا وطهورا إلا في محل النجس أو مغصوب أو في مقبرة أو حمام أو أعطان الإبل، أما المغصوب فتصح الصلاة فيه والإثم على مغتصبه، وأما المحل النجس فالصلاة فيه ممنوعة، ولكن لو صلاها فهي صحيحة مع ترتب الإثم على الفعل. أما المقبرة والحمام أو أعطان الإبل فالأصل عدم صحة الصلاة فيها، وفي سنن الترمذي مرفوعا أي عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم الأرض كلها مسجد إلا المقبرة والحمام، والحمام ليس هو المرحاض أو دورة المياه، وإنما الحمام هو موضع الغسل، موضع الاستحمام، وهو مظنة القاذورات والتقذرات والخبائث وانكشاف العورات. لذلك نهى النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام عن الصلاة فيه، وفي هذا القدر كفاية. وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين، وآخر دعوانا أن الحمد لله.
The Shaykh continues by saying, Hafizahullah, that the Shaykh al-Sa'di, Rahimahullah, has stated, also from the shuroot, also from the requirement of salah, is to face the Qibla. And this has been stated in the Quran in Surah Al-Baqarah, Surah Al-Baqarah, verse number 149 and 150, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, "And from wheresoever you start forth your prayers, turn your face in the direction of Al-Masjid Al-Haram. That is indeed the truth from your Lord, and Allah is not unaware of what you do. And from wheresoever you start forth for prayers, turn your face in the direction of Al-Masjid Al-Haram. And wheresoever you are, turn your faces towards it when you pray, so that men may have no argument against you except those of them that are wrongdoers. So fear them not, but fear me, and so that I may complete my blessings on you, and that you may be guided." 149 and 150. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned this in Surah Al-Baqarah, and also the Shaykh points out, if the person is not able to face the Qibla, to face the direction of the Qibla due to illness or something of this nature, therefore that requirement is dropped. Just like other requirements will be dropped if it is due to an immediate need or something that has restricted him from it. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, in Surah At-Taghabun, verse number 16, فَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ مَا اسْتَطَعْتُمْ, fear Allah as much as you have been given the ability. And also we see النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم has said, describing that a person who is in a state of travel, that he صلى الله عليه وسلم, he himself, he used to pray his nafla prayers, his involuntary prayer, his voluntary prayers, other than the five daily prayers, he used to pray them while sitting on his mount. Wherever his mount was turned to, or whichever direction he was in, his salah was valid. And that hadith is muttafaqun alayh. And in another narration, غير أنه, except that he would not pray his written, or the five daily prayers, while on his mount. He would descend and turn and face the Qibla with his prayer. Also from the shurut, from the requirements of salah, these are the things that must be done before you enter into the salah. You have to turn, find the Qibla, you have to make wudu, all of this. Obviously, the requirement that must be preceding the salah is a niyyah, sincere intention to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the niyyah is done in the heart and not with the tongue. And salah is accepted in every place that you pray. It is accepted wherever you pray on the face of the earth, except if you are going to pray in a place that is najis, impure. You can't make salah in a place that is impure. And you should not make salah in land that has been taken unjustly. But the Shaykh says that the salah is accepted if you pray in land that has been seized unjustly. Someone has stolen something, a property, and you pray in that property, your salah is valid, although the person will get the sin of having stole that. Also, you are not permitted, it is invalid, your prayer is not accepted in a graveyard or in a hammam. And the hammam, it means a place of bathing where people gather and they bathe and they clean themselves, and this is because the najasat is usually there. Or in the places, the stables of camels, you are not permitted to pray there. And we see this, there's a hadith in the Sunan of Al-Imam Al-Tirmidhi, and the hadith is marfu'ah, where it is stated that all of the earth is a masjid, except the graveyard and the hammam, and the place of bathing where people gather, and there's lots of najasat and things of that nature. And this is where we conclude with you today. We will continue once again tomorrow, inshaAllah, the same time in the same place, inshaAllah ta'ala. We will begin the chapter of the description of the prayer of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, which will be the final paragraph on page 24. So inshallah we will try to entertain some of your questions for the few minutes inshallah ta'ala. Naam Idris.
Thank you.
The question that is being asked, if the woman is in istihada, meaning that it is natural bleeding from a vein or something of this nature, and they are sure that the blood, it is not the blood of the period, and it's not in the time period of her menstrual cycle, and yet she is bleeding, can her husband have sexual relations with her? The Sheikh answers, the husband can have sexual relations with her. There is no requirement that she has to bathe before or that she has to make wudu before. As long as it is not, and it is known that it is not from the menstrual cycle.
العورة
الركبة ليست من العورة، وبالتالي فما فوق الركبة إلى السرة هذا العورة، الركبة ليست عورة، لأن الرسول يقول ما بين الركبة والسرة عورة، فالركبة خارجة.
The question that is being asked is, where does the awra end? Is it at the bottom part of the knee or at the top of the knee? The Shaykh, hafizahullah, he answers by saying the knee is not part of the awra, meaning that it is at the top part of the knee, meaning the knee is not part of the awra, it can't be exposed. A person's knee, it's not awra, for the man, obviously, of course. The awra, it is from the navel to the knee, not below the knee, or else the Rasulullah would have said, to the shin. So it is to the knee, meaning to the beginning or the top of the knee. No. That hadith is unauthentic. Any hadith that states that the Rasulullah there is no hadith that mentions that the Rasulullah prayed without something covering his shoulder. No.
نعم، أما أن المؤمن لا ينجس في حديث صحيح، نقول المؤمن لا ينجس حتى ولو أصابته جنابة. أما قوله تعالى لا يمسه إلا المطهرون، فنعم المطهرون هم الملائكة، ولا يجوز الاستدلال بهذه الآية على منع مس المصحف للجنب، ولكننا نحن نستدل على ذلك بقوله عليه الصلاة والسلام لبعض أصحابه لا تمس القرآن إلا وأنت طاهر، لا تمس القرآن إلا وأنت طاهر، هذا هو الدليل. وبالتالي فنحن في مثل هذه المسألة نرجح ما نرى أنه صواب، ولا نشدد ولا نبدع. قد نغلط، نعم نغلط ونخطئ، لكن لا نبدع ولا نشدد ولا نؤثم. والمسألة خلافية كما ذكرت وأكرر بين كبار أهل العلم قديما وحديثا، والله أعلم. بل أنا كنت أقول يعني في معظم عمري، ولعل هذا منذ سنتين أو ثلاثة فقط غيرت هذه الفتوى، وإلا كنت أقول بالجواز مطلقا، والله أعلم.
The Sheikh continues, the question that is being asked is, we have heard that a person should not hold the Qur'an when he is in a state of janaba. So how do we answer those who say that Rasulullah ﷺ says the mu'min, the believer, never becomes impure, and that the ayah that is referred to in Surah Al-Waqi'ah, that only the pure are permitted to hold it, is in reference to the angels and the lawh al-mahfuz. The Sheikh... The Sheikh answers by saying, yes, the Rasulullah ﷺ, it is authentically reported that only the believer, a believer never becomes impure, and also the ayah in Surah Al-Waqi'ah is in reference to the angels. This is not the proof that we were using. we say to you that the Rasul has told some of his Sahaba, do not touch the Quran unless you are in a state of purity, meaning while you're in Janaba, do not hold the Quran. And that is an authentically reported hadith. And after stating that, we do not ever say that a person who holds the Quran, he is in a state of bid'ah, or that he has earned a great deal of evil deeds, but we do say that it is a mistake. And he says that this thing, it is part of ijtihad and things of this nature. And for this reason, the Shaykh says, we do not prefer the way the question was worded that they state, because all of it is something that we are learning about al-Islam. They are us. We are all together as people. And the Shaykh continues by saying, this is an issue where some of the scholars have stated that it's permitted totally, as he mentioned that about 2 or 3 years ago when he was asked questions similar to this, he would say, and I remember because I was translating, he would say it was something that was permitted to hold the Mus'haf. But he says, due to the evidences that have been shown and the researches that have been done, it is something where we say it is not to be done. The person should not hold the Mus'haf with his hand if he is in a state of impurity due to janabah. Now.
That will be discussed in the chapter of the absence of salah. So we'll wait for that. يقول تماما أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم كان لا يصلي الصلاة المكتوبة وهو على راحلته، لكن بعض الإخوة يقرر أنهم يفات أو يفات
يجوز ذلك في أقصى الضرورة إذا لم يكن هنالك مجال للجمع ويخشى أن تفوته الصلاة كليا فيجوز.
The question that was asked of the Sheikh, some brothers are required to travel great distances at some times, and they have heard, we have just heard that that the Rasul ﷺ did not pray the salah al-maktuba, the compulsory prayers, while he was on his mount. Yet some of us are forced at some times to pray it. What is the answer to this? The Sheikh says, if it is the only course of action, then it is permitted to be prayed. But the Sheikh says, if you have the ability to join the prayers, meaning before you get on the train or the plane, you pray the dhuhr at the time of dhuhr and include with it asr, and therefore you have those 6 or 7 hours until maghrib, that would be better. But if you're going to be on the plane or wherever and you don't have the ability to join the prayers, and this is why we have been given the rukhsah of joining the prayers, then you may pray the obligatory prayer only if there is no other way. Now. That will be covered in our next discussions, inshallah. Now.
يقول هو بيشتغل في بعض الأماكن الماء فيها منقطعة، هل عليه يجب عليه أن يحمل الماء لها يفض بها أو يتيمم؟
إذا استطاع يحمل الماء ولم يكن ذلك تعثيرا عليه فهو الأولى.
The question that is asked of the Sheikh, some brothers work in isolated areas where there's no running water. Is it required upon them to carry water with them that will suffice them for their wudu? The Sheikh says, if they have the ability to carry the water with them and it's not a great discomfort, something that they can do, then they should carry the water with them. Otherwise, they can make tayammum in the place that they are in. Naam, ya'i.
نعم الصحابة أوكي. يقول صاحب كتاب فقه السنة كتب أن الصحابة هذا الرجل لو عنده دائما هو دائما
السلف هذا يسمى السلف أو العذر. نعم نحن نقول كذلك إذا كان هنالك رجل عنده مرض بخلت البول أن بوله لا ينقطع مثلا ينقط نقطا أو أنه يخرج الأرياح مستمرا فإنه يتوضأ لكل فريضة ويصلي ما بين الوقتين ما شاء أن يصلي ويشترط وضوء عند وضوئه للفريضة إذا دخل وقتها. إذا دخل وقت الفريضة
The question that is asked of the Sheikh, we have read in Fiqh al-Sunnah that the author has stated that a person who has an illness that causes him to release gas, flatulence constantly and he doesn't have control over it, that he can be in the same category as a woman who has natural bleeding. The Sheikh says it is a different category, it's called the Salaf, and this is a person who has a medical illness where he will drop certain drops of urine and he can't control it, or he will be constantly making flatulence that he has no control over. For him, for that person, it is required for him, it is required upon him that he makes wudu at the time of every salah and that he cleanses himself before every salah so that he can pray the prayer. And when the salah time enters, he is required to make the wudu and to be prepared. I know.
يجوز لمس المصحف بدون وضوء مثل الحدث الأصغر الحدث الأصغر.
نعم doesn't have. The Sheikh says in regards to holding the Quran or the Mus'haf without wudu due to minor hadath, it should not be done. It should not be done. And this is where we will conclude for today. We will continue with you tomorrow, inshallah. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.